This is going to be really scary.
Undead from Universal Studios in Hollywood, California. The monster movie capital of the world. It's the Horror Hall of Fame. An all-star tribute to terror. Starring Robert Englund. With special appearances by Forrest J. Ackerman, Linda Blair, Big Bob, Veronica Cartwright, Roger Corman, Sarah Karloff Cotton, Chucky, the Crypt Keeper, Phyllis Diller, Joe Dante, William Friedkin, Catherine Hicks, Pat Hitchcock, Jason, Sam Kinison, John Landis, Janet Leigh, Tim Matheson, Ronnie McDowell, Jason Miller, Anthony Perkins, Danny Pintaro, Vincent Price, Joan Rivers, Zelda Rubinstein, Ridley Scott, Tom Skerritt, plus lots of horrifying surprises starting with me. I'm Cato Stevens. The Horror Hall of Fame is brought to you by Dentene. We'll take care of your breath. The rest is up to you. And by Hulsa Shampoo and Conditioner. The word means health. The name means beautiful. And by Ultra Slim Fast, a delicious, healthy way to lose weight. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your host this evening, the Nightmare from Elm Street, Mr. Robert Englund.
Good evening. Good evening, and welcome to the first annual Horror Hall of Fame. Tonight, I'm honored to help honor the movies and the artists that have brought our nightmares to life. Our inductees span both the classic and the contemporary, from the murderous mummy of ancient Egypt to the high-tech terrors of hyperspace. But they all have one thing in common. Through the years, they've haunted us and horrified us. So tonight, they'll get exactly what they deserve, a place in the Horror Hall of Fame. To start things off is an actress who really knows how to play hard to get. Captain Kirk pursued her in Star Trek IV. And Chucky almost caught her in Child's Play. But we finally got her. To present our first honoree, please welcome Catherine Hicks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. When our first honoree premiered in 1973, it made a frightful first impression. And a sweet little girl got an Oscar nomination for a movie debut that was a real head-turner. Ladies and gentlemen, our first inductee into the Horror Hall of Fame, The Exorcist.
A lot of horror films are made just to scare.
You're gonna die up there.
But here, it really got under people's skins.
Father Kerosene's my little girl.
Because it made evil real.
Mrs. McNeil.
Yes.
I'm Father Mary.
On July 25th, 1971, The Exorcist took possession of the number one spot on the New York Times bestseller list. William Peter Blatty's story of a little girl whose body becomes a battleground between good and evil was to become the most disturbing, realistic horror film in the history of Hollywood.
One night I started reading it and I just couldn't put it down. I thought it was the most powerful and one of the most profound novels that I had ever read. I called Blatty and I said, Bill, this is great. It's just wonderful. And he said, you really like it? I said, I think it's fantastic. He said, would you like to do the movie? I said, Jesus, do the movie? Well, yeah, I guess so, sure.
Friedkin's demand for realism led actor Jason Miller to live with the Jesuits for a month to prepare for his role as Father Karras. During that time, Miller was given a rare opportunity to study the evidence of evil.
They allowed me to read the original diary, which was kept under lock and key in the chancery. And this original diary documented day by day by day by day the original exorcism on which Blatty based his novel.
Keep away! The sow is mine!
Linda Blair was not sent for this job by her agent. Linda's mother brought her in. And I could see immediately that her attitude about it was so open, so flexible.
Do you know what she did?
Linda Blair was really quite extraordinary. She was a very mature 12-year-old lady, very self-possessed. She was a wonderful person to work with. I mean, for instance, I had to cast her head for the dummy, where the head rotated, with her eyes open and smiling. Now, for her to hold that is very, very difficult. You get very claustrophobic when you're buried under all this molding material. She did it better than any adult I've ever worked with.
The actress earned an Academy Award nomination, and because of her professional approach to the satanic storyline, she was spared any psychological scars.
Movie's a movie and work is work, and it's not what the story's about. Now, as an adult, I look at it and I say, I'm not so sure I would do it as an adult. It was tough.
The film's ominous opening was filmed on location in Iraq. But for the scenes of exorcism, a New York soundstage was specially equipped to create an authentically chilling atmosphere.
It would be 17 below in the mornings when we would come in. And by the time we lit and we did some work, it would come up to zero, and that's the temperature they wanted to keep it at.
Director Friedkin also used an unusual technique for creating an explosive air of disquiet on the set.
I used to fire blank gunshots all over the set, all the time, that would get people really shook up. I made them feel from time to time as though they were in a war zone, which is what the film was supposed to look like.
When The Exorcist opened on the day after Christmas, 1973, it was $6 million over budget. It was the target of protest from religious groups, mental health experts, and parents' organizations across America. And it was the biggest hit of the year.
Well, actually, I think it's more than a horror film. I think it's got a dimension, a whole theological dimension that other horror films simply don't have.
If you're the devil, why not make the straps disappear?
That's much too vulgar display of power, Karis.
It's a terribly believable film. You're caught up in this story of a mother and her child. The most terrifying thing that can happen to a parent. Something's happening to her child.
I want you to tell me that you know for a fact that there's nothing wrong with my daughter except in her mind. You tell me you know for a fact that an exorcism wouldn't do any good. You tell me that!
Laddie portrays evil as evil. There's no question about it. The demonic force that takes over this little child, whatever it is or whatever it may be, is really evil and bad and dangerous and frightening.
And it's an unbelievable movie, so I appreciate it each time that I watch it. And at the same time, I'm careful not to watch it before I go to bed.
I command you, by the judge of the living and the dead, to depart from the servant of God. By this sign of the holy cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Damien!
Amen.
Exactly. To accept the award on behalf of The Exorcist, please welcome the Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright and star of The Exorcist and The Exorcist 3, Jason Miller.
It's a great privilege to receive this tribute. And I would just like to mention the people who made this film the spectacular success that it was. That's William Friedkin and William Peter Blatty, Linda Blair, Lee J. Cobb, God rest his soul, Max von Sydow, and most especially Reverend Father William O'Malley, who was an inspiration to us all. Again, I thank you very much.
All of tonight's inductees have been chosen by an internationally renowned board of directors who themselves have made lasting contributions to the genre. But there's one award we'll be presenting tonight that's been selected by audiences across America. The Best Horror Film of the Year. Our first nominee is a fantasy thriller about a brilliant young scientist whose world blows up in his face. And while he was obsessed with vengeance, audiences were obsessed with the burning question, who is Darkman?
I know, Rick. I know you did. But let's pretend you didn't.
Hosting the first annual Horror Hall of Fame is a grave responsibility. So I dug up an old friend of mine, a real old friend of mine, to give me a hand. From HBO's Tales from the Crypt, The Crypt Keeper.
Thanks, Robert. I'll be happy to lend you a hand. Just make sure you get it back by Tuesday. Don't go away, you gore hounds, because Sam Kinison's coming up, and we know he's a real scream!
Wanna go psycho with me, Elvira, here at the Bates Motel? Look for me wherever they sell mug root beer. And enter the Go Psycho with Elvira contest. You can be my guest at Universal Studios in Hollywood for a monstrous bash at the Bates Motel. Shower anyone? This Halloween, go psycho with Elvira and win a party with mug root beer and me.
I love my mug.
I love it.
Our next presenter is a producer-director whose very first film was Monster from the Ocean Floor. His latest creation is Frankenstein Unbound. And in between, he's made over 200 movies, including three memorable ones starring our next inductee. Ladies and gentlemen, my old boss, Roger Corman.
As a young director in 1960, it was my privilege to work with this next honoree on the film The Raven. Now, as a not-so-young director, I'm privileged again to present him as the next inductee of the Horror Hall of Fame, Boris Karloff.
Afraid, my dear? There's nothing to be afraid of.
Boris Karloff, the movie's grandmaster of horror, began life as William Henry Pratt, born in 1887, just outside London. Though it's unclear where he got the name, he was calling himself Boris Karloff when he came to Hollywood, where he found work in silent films, frequently as a villain.
I don't like you.
What's that?
Karloff had appeared in nearly 100 movies, but was still a relative unknown when a producer from Universal Pictures remembered him as a surly inmate in The Criminal Code. Dracula had been Universal's surprise hit of the year, and its star, Bela Lugosi, was scheduled to appear in the studio's horror follow-up. But the new role required extensive makeup, and the character had no lines, so Lugosi passed on the part, and suddenly, fate took Karloff's hand.
It's alive. It's alive. It's alive. It's alive. It's alive.
Frankenstein, perhaps the greatest horror movie of all, was the turning point for Karloff. He was over 40 when shooting began, and the role was physically taxing and professionally challenging. Each day, legendary makeup artist Jack Pierce took hours to transform Karloff into the monster. For weeks, Boris lumbered around Universal's back lot in asphalt spreader's boots under layers of rubber, putty, and paint, baking under the hot studio lights. Despite the hardships, Karloff made the creature both tender and terrifying. And today, the monster still stands as the testament to his talent. After 15 years,
before us was an overnight star.
I didn't catch your name.
Arthur Bay.
The next year, he was back in makeup, giving another eerie, affecting performance as an ancient Egyptian prince returned from the dead and trying to escape the curse of the mummy. By now, his fame was so great that he was billed simply as Karloff. And in The Black Cat, he was teen for the first time with the man who helped put him at the top.
He has an intense and all-consuming horror.
Lugosi and Karloff were teamed again in The Raven before Boris resurrected his most famous role.
Frankenstein.
In 1935, the horror movie's most memorable creature returned in The Bride of Frankenstein. Critics said it surpassed the original, and James Whale's witty direction and gallows humor complimented Karloff's sympathetic creature, who finally sets things right for both his creator and his monstrous new mate.
Yes, go. You live. Go. You stay. We belong dead.
Boris was the screen's undisputed king of horror. Outstanding roles in The Invisible Ray, Tower of London, and The Black Room solidified his status, and Karloff closed off the 30s with The Son of Frankenstein, his final screen appearance as the creature.
Do you ever see the lads play knife? Toddy'd like to do that all over my body.
In the 40s, Karloff moved to RKO Pictures, where he starred in Bedlam, Isle of the Dead, and The Body Snatcher. Three understated, atmospheric chillers.
Well, now, this might be a good place for me to go into a little dance, but no, even for me, that would be too frightening.
By the 50s, Boris had become a popular guest on TV and radio, where he frequently enjoyed poking fun at his fearsome screen image.
Hey, doctor, you sure you can cure me?
Of course,
I didn't think I was sick when I come in here. But
oh, but you're very sick. I can cure you.
Can you, doctor?
I had a patient last week just like you, and I took care of him.
Oh, yeah, well, I'd like to meet him.
Oh, I'm not going to dig him up just for that.
In the 60s, Karloff starred for American International Pictures in films like Black Sabbath, The Raven, and The Terror. But in the movie Targets, he gives a kind of farewell performance. As Byron Orlok, a fading film star, Karloff could well be speaking about himself as he reminisces about his life as a screen legend.
Mr. Boogeyman, King of Blood, they used to call me. Box Brothers make you laugh. Garvel makes you weep. Orlok makes you scream.
On February 2nd, 1969, Boris Karloff died at the age of 81. Throughout his long career, even in his most menacing roles, the gentle manner of the man is unmistakable. It's easy to see why five generations of moviegoers cherish the memory of William Henry Pratt and salute Boris Karloff, the man whose singular talent for terror gave life to the movie's most magnificent monster and made him live in our hearts forever.
Holy God.
To accept the award for Boris Karloff is his daughter, Sarah Karloff Cotton.
Thank you all very much. This is a wonderful tribute to my father's career. However, in person, he was the gentlest of human beings, so it's ironic that it was this sort of a part that gained him notoriety and fame, but thank you very much for remembering him this evening.
For horror fans, plenty of new blood is ready to hit the screen. And we've got a sneak peek at some of the best. They're world screamers. And who better to share them with us than the man of your screams, Sam Kinison!
I've just met Sarah Karloff, and I'm like, you know, I had a little trouble wondering why I was here tonight, because I know it was the, Hall of Fame. I have to say it just right, because, you know, people are expecting something from me on a joke like that. But I've had some experiences in horror. I was married twice, and and my movie agent's been legally dead for 3 years. Oh, ah! So, he has no pulse. But anyway, let's go with the films. Psycho 4 tells the story of a young Norman Bates. This is some kid. He cuts class and everything else. Oh, oh!
I may be well now, but I'm not cured. I'll never be cured.
Norman!
In Jacob's Ladder, a postal clerk starts seeing really unbelievable things, like mail being delivered on time for a change.
Where are you taking me? Where am I?
Where do you want to go?
Home.
This is your home. You're dead.
I'm not dead.
What are you then?
I'm alive.
Maniac cop. Doors don't stop him. Walls don't stop him. Bullets don't stop him. Has anyone tried a donut?
It must be visiting hours, because my friend is back!
Graveyard Shift. Stephen King's newest film stars a fat, hairy, slimy monster that eats everything in sight. Only this one doesn't sing the national anthem. Dark Shadows is back. The story of a monster who will suck the life right out of you. Oh, they call them vampires. You know what I call them? Divorce attorneys! Oh, ah! Thank you. It's been a pleasure being here at the Horror Hall of Fame, and I'm going to go back, and since I've dug my own grave with some of those intros here in show business, thank you for having me tonight. Thank you very much.
I'd like you all to meet a friend of mine tonight who's really good at making me look really bad. The makeup artist who gets Freddy ready, and the designer of the Horror Hall of Fame Award, Mr. Kevin Yeager. Now, since Halloween is creeping up on us, we invited another master makeup artist to demonstrate his magic. So joining us from his monster lab is the man who created special effect makeups for Ghostbusters and The Abyss, the other Magic Johnson, Steve Johnson. And with him is his wife, Hollywood's reigning screen queen, Linnea Quigley.
Thanks, Robert. You know, gang, to do effective makeups like we do in Hollywood, you don't need complicated state-of-the-art equipment or expensive materials. All you really need is a good imagination. Watch this. There's lots of stuff you can do at home for Halloween. Take teeth, for example. Now, Linnea's got really nice clean white teeth, but for Halloween, they're a little too clean. So we come up with a way that you can make scary monster teeth with ordinary chewy fruit candy and a common everyday household mallet. So just beat it into a nice work consistency. Okay, now that we've got the candy worked into a nice soft consistency, the next step is to put it into the mouth. So first of all, we'll take the cherry flavored because it makes a nice gum color and place it into Linnea's mouth like this. Dick Smith, one of the all-time greats in makeup, actually invented this technique using chewing gum and peanuts. So you can see there's all kinds of variations. And now you've got some brand new scary monster gums. Next, we'll put the fangs in. So take the lemon flavor, roll them up into some nice, scary, pointed monster fangs, and it's a simple matter from that point to just stick them on where you like them. I always find that if you leave a lot of gum showing, when you're making monster dentures, it looks a little bit scarier because animals always show a lot of gums when they're in a frightening mood. So have fun with it.
Listen, we've got the steamy story behind the psycho shower scene, plus more monster makeups with Steve and Linnea. But first, a little torture. Commercial.
Guess what? You're invited to the Halloween party of the year.
Miller Lite's big Halloween haunt.
Right, big man. 160 very lucky people will be flown to Universal Studios Hollywood.
Find this special can hidden in 12 packs and cases of Miller Lite. It's your invitation to go.
Oh, and 45,000 of the prizes. Details of a Miller Lite is sold.
Man, it's gonna be a scream.
From Universal Studios Hollywood, the Horror Hall of Fame continues.
An epic fantasy adventure is our next nominee for Best Horror Film of the Year. When an accused murderer finds refuge in an isolated city inhabited by a race of monsters, audiences discover a whole new breed of terror, Nightbreed.
Pay no attention. Just give her to me. Babette, no! What's happening to him? What? Is it sick? What's happening to him?
Mom, help me.
What the hell is this?
She likes to play outside. I tell her the sun will hurt her. She's just a child. She doesn't understand.
She likes to play outside.
Our next presenter used to spend his entire allowance on the movies, and that turned out to be a pretty good investment, because he turned out to be an actor, writer, director, and producer. He's soon to be seen in Stephen King's new thriller, And Sometimes They Come Back. Please welcome Tim Matheson.
Thank you. In 1960, moviegoers were eager to check out the latest film by the man whose face was as familiar as the stars he directed. And when Janet Leigh checked into the Bates Motel, it changed the course of horror history. Our third inductee, Psycho.
Here we have a quiet little motel, tucked away off the main highway, and as you see, perfectly harmless looking, when in fact, it has now become known as the scene of the crime.
I think Hitchcock made Psycho out of frustration and boredom. He was constantly in search of something different. And when he found the book, Psycho, written by Robert Bloch, he thought that this was something new, a kind of movie that he hadn't made before, an out-and-out shocker.
Shocking details about the unassuming personality of real-life mass murderer Ed Gein gave writer Robert Bloch the grisly inspiration for the character who's been called the Hamlet of Horror.
I said there's got to be more of a personality behind such a series of killings. So I had to invent one, and I invented Norman Bates.
This young man, you had to feel sorry for him. After all, being dominated by an almost maniacal woman was enough to drive anyone to the extreme of, well, let's go in.
Well, I run the office, and tend the cabins and grounds, and do little errands for my mother, the ones she allows I might be capable of doing.
And do you go out with friends?
Well, a boy's best friend is his mother.
I love the scene in Norman's parlor. There was such symbolism in that scene. And what was to be was all there. And yet, the words were so that you weren't sure that maybe there wasn't going to be something between the two.
It's not as if she were a maniac, a raving thing. She just goes a little mad sometimes. We all go a little mad sometimes. Haven't you?
Hitchcock planned Psycho to be shot in just 36 days on the meticulously tight budget of only $800,000. He slashed costs by filming in black and white, avoiding glamorous, expensive locations, and using the crew from his hit TV series. But when it came to Psycho's startling shower scene, even his closest associates thought he'd gone a little mad.
Psycho is a very controversial movie. There are many reasons for that. The fact that a major star, Janet Leigh, was murdered in the film a third of the way through the movie was completely disorienting to audiences. Also, the way she was killed, there's a tremendous suggestion of nudity and extreme violence as well. You really don't see anything, but your mind plays enormous tricks on you, and that's what Hitchcock bargained on, that an audience's imagination was stronger than anything, and that's what happened.
He said he wanted to do something on the screen to shock the people, but yet not show the knife penetrating or the body or anything like that. So he laid this out in cuts, and it now has become one of the famous sequences in motion pictures. And we shot in this shower scene for a whole week on this 30-some day schedule. We spent over 5 days just shooting the shower scene. And it was, well, to this day, I look back on it and I can almost remember every day of it. It was a great experience.
Well, Hitchcock in the shower scene knew exactly what he wanted for blood. Shasta had just come out with chocolate syrup that you could squirt in a plastic bottle, revolutionary for its day. And he said that's what he wanted. I think another anecdote that people find amusing about Psycho is what Hitchcock used for the sound of the knife entering Janet Leigh's body in that shower scene. And his sound man, knowing what a perfectionist he was, had this table set up with every kind of melon one could imagine, Crenshaws and honeydews and watermelons. And Hitchcock just sat in a chair with his arms folded very, very stoically and listened with his eyes closed as this man went down the row, stabbing each melon one by one. And Hitchcock, at the end of the session, intoned very quietly, cassava, and that was the sound that he had in his head of what a body sounded like being stabbed by a butcher knife.
Hitchcock relished the fact that Psycho's other sadistic set piece was shot in the same studio where Lon Chaney, the master of silent screen horror, had made his chilling entrance as the Phantom of the Opera.
Now, it was at the top of these stairs that the second murder took place.
She came out of the door there
and met the victim at the top. Of course, in a flash, there was the knife, and in no time, the victim tumbled and fell with a horrible crash. I think the back broke immediately and hit the floor. It's difficult to describe the way that the twisting
In advance of the film's premiere, Hitchcock made sure that moviegoers were tantalized by his own personal publicity campaign.
I insist that you do not tell your friends the little tiny horrifying secrets of Psycho after you see it.
Psycho broke records everywhere from the day it opened. People were lined up around the corners, and the movie hadn't even been reviewed by the critics. Psycho opened on June 16th of 1960. It was still playing in theaters in November. First-run theaters. It was an enormous hit.
Psycho became the most talked about, most imitated, and most successful film of Hitchcock's career. And though it owes much to the work of dozens of talented people on both sides of the camera, clearly, it was the vision of Alfred Hitchcock that guided Psycho to greatness.
If Psycho is a classic, it's because Hitchcock made it so. He made the audience care about the characters and therefore care about what happened to them. And in that, he was way ahead of his time.
You see, many of the people that have attempted to imitate Psycho think that Psycho is a movie about a shower scene. It is not. It is a movie about human beings and their problems and their secrets. And the fact that some of those secrets are horrifying.
To me, to honor Psycho is honoring Sir Alfred Hitchcock. You know, he was nominated 5 times for the Academy Award and never won once. I think the year that we were both nominated for Psycho, I felt worse for him than for me, because I was hoping that this would be the one that he would win. But so I really am proud that we can do this to honor him in this way. I think he's a genius.
For Psycho is one of Hitchcock's and Hollywood's most glamorous leading ladies, despite the fact she hasn't been able to get near a shower in 30 years. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Janet Leigh.
I am indeed pleased to be a small part of this wonderful tribute to a man I truly deeply loved and admired. He would have some wonderful quip to make. I unfortunately don't have that kind of command, so I will just say how proud I am. It's kind of like a reunion tonight as well for me, because here is a lady who knew Hitch better than any of us. My friend, my psycho colleague, Pat Hitchcock.
Thank you, Janet, so much. I would like to thank the Horror Hall of Fame for recognizing my father, and I would like to accept this lovely award on behalf of my father and also all of the wonderful people who were behind the scenes and in front of the camera for Psycho. Thank you very much indeed.
Want to buy a house? You might be able to make a pretty good deal for this place when you consider that the original building price was $15,000 back in 1960, when Alfred Hitchcock commissioned it to be built for his original picture, Psycho. I'm sure that Hitch would be happy to know that Psycho has been inducted into the Horror Hall of Fame. And on his behalf, I thank you.
Hitchcock was my hero. When he yelled cut, you never knew if he meant kill the scene or kill the actors. Tony will be back later in the show, along with the Night of the Living Dead. But first, something even more deadly. More commercials!
To present our next award are two fine actors. One co-stars every week with Tony Danza, and the other has no co-stars because he kills them all. So please welcome from Who's the Boss and Cujo, Danny Pintauro, and from Friday the 13th, my nemesis, Jason.
For decades, vampires, mummies, and werewolves got all the good parts in Hollywood's horror movies. Right, Jason? But in 1968, zombies invaded Pittsburgh and Pennsylvania, replaced Transylvania as the new home of horror. Our fourth inductee, Night of the Living Dead.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
This is the latest disclosure in a report from National Civil Defense Headquarters in Washington. The unburied dead are coming back to life and seeking human victims.
Good Lord.
Medical examination of victims' bodies shows conclusively that the killers are eating the flesh of the people they kill. It is happening, and it would appear that no one is safe from this wave of mass murder.
To anyone who's experienced the uncompromising terror of Night of the Living Dead, it's obvious that the film isn't just another typical Hollywood horror story. It was created by a small team of producers at a Pittsburgh-area ad agency who decided to turn their talents to movie making.
It had taken us a number of years of doing commercials and always working toward the goal of making a feature. By us, I mean George Romero, Russ Striner, and myself, and the other people that work with us at Latent Image. And literally the first week that we owned a 35mm camera, we said, let's make a feature now.
The group decided that George Romero, the man with the most experience shooting film, would direct.
And so we said, we'll do a horror movie, you know, which was fine with me because I've always loved the genre.
Romero, Russo, Striner, and some other friends each put up $600. Relatives and business associates were also persuaded to invest in the project. But they still had to make their movie for less than many 30-second commercials cost. So they kept their plans modest.
The only thing that we made a conscious, concerted effort to do was to do the best film we could with our $60,000.
Russo and Romero came up with a screenplay inspired by I Am Legend, Richard Matheson's story of the recently dead who come back to life in search of human blood. Locations were selected, and the cast, a mixture of professional actors and friends, was assembled. At the beginning, they called their film The Night of the Flesh Eaters, and shooting began in the summer of 67.
All of us had to wear many, many hats, so you might find me changing magazines and wearing ghoul makeup while I'm doing it.
For the real aficionados of the film, they see George Romero playing the part of a TV reporter, and that was a sequence that I filmed. So we all kind of did whatever we had to do to get it done.
Striner also played an important role on screen as the ghoul's first victim.
I was a warm, willing body, as opposed to some very, very tough casting audition.
That's not true. I think he did an excellent job, and certainly his famous line in the cemetery has stuck with horror fans for the past 22 years.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
Judy O'Day as Barbara brought a tremendous energy to her part. She seemed as if she was really frightened, afraid for her life. And she ran like a demon when she was being pursued by the zombies, and she never did let up for a minute. Dwayne Jones was very intelligent and sensitive, and he certainly was responsible to a large degree for the believability of the picture.
After working in their spare time for more than a year, the producers sold their finished film to a distributor. They discovered that the Flesh Eaters had been used, so they gave the movie a brand new title. The world premiere was in Pittsburgh in October 1968.
We went out and brought popcorn and went out and watched it at a drive-in. And that was a big moment, too, because we could actually go out and see one of our movies in a drive-in, man. So that, we were in the big time.
Night of the Living Dead was a box office success from the start. But its reputation as something more than just another horror film grew when it began a two-year run as the midnight feature at Greenwich Village's Waverly Theater.
And it became one of those movies that people went to, you know, goof on and recite the dialogue to and sit and watch over and over and over and over and over.
The movie quickly became a cult favorite, and critics began to take notice. Rex Reed, movie critic for the New York Daily News, wrote, "If you want to see what turns a B-movie into a classic, don't miss Night of the Living Dead." The prestigious British film journal, Sight and Sound, said, "If you do like horror films, this may well be the most horrifying ever made." And the movie was even screened at the Museum of Modern Art.
Night of the Living Dead was one of the few horror films at that time that did treat horror seriously. And it's probably very frightening because everybody's afraid of death, and now you have a death that's not even final. you die and you come back, and the dead turn on the living. And so it's sort of death multiplied exponentially.
Action zombies!
Now, after more than 20 years, the producers have gotten together to bring a new version of their terrifying tale to the screen.
I think the remake of Night of the Living Dead is going to have the same impact as the original. And I think it's what it's going to do is reaffirm all the reasons why the first picture was successful.
The film has grossed over $15 million at the box office and has been translated into 17 languages. And despite remakes, sequels, and dozens of imitators, no picture has surpassed the stark power of the black and white classic. John Russo offers what may be the definitive explanation for Night of the Living Dead's enduring appeal.
I heard an interview once with Tommy Dorsey, and they asked him why did his music stand the test of time, and he said, well, you know, because it was pretty good music. And that's probably the truest thing that could be said for Night of the Living Dead. It was a real good horror film. It scares people, and that's what horror films are supposed to do.
Help me! Oh, help me!
Producers Russ Schreiner and John Russo.
Well, on behalf of Deadheads Everywhere, thank you very much. We would be a bit remiss if we didn't thank the co-producer on the film, Carl Hardman, and a very special thanks to our good pal, George Romero, who unfortunately is on location tonight. He sends his warmest regards and thanks you very much.
I'd like to thank the entire cast and crew who worked so hard to help us make a hit picture on a shoestring. And also, we consider this award a tribute to Dwayne Jones, who is no longer with us. Thank you very much.
A good gash doesn't have to leave you scarred for life. All you need is some unflavored gelatin, some simple grease paint. Just mix up the gelatin with hot water according to directions, and then make sure you let it cool a little bit before you apply it to the skin, and you're ready to go. Just apply the gelatin in the area of the wound, and make sure you keep the edges of the wound thinned down a little bit so that it looks as though you're building up a deeper area toward the middle. Let it dry for a few minutes, and then add some powder. That keeps it from sticking to itself. Brush off the excess. And all that's left now is a little paint. So, start out with some deep red and black. That'll give you a nice illusion of depth. The next thing we need to do now is make the gelatin actually look like part of Linnea's neck. So, I'll put a little flesh color paint on it. Now I'm just gonna model it up a little bit with some purples and blues for bruises. And yellow, never forget the yellow. That looks pretty good for a quickie. Yeah, I know. We'll add some safety pins for a really gruesome effect. And make sure the safety pins are razor sharp, because if they're not, you might ruin your makeup. Now we'll add one last pin. Oh! Well, I guess you better forget the pins.
I don't know if this is face powder or my dear departed sister Helen. Next, you'll meet the man who really gave Stephen King something to write about. Thinking of departing, my dearies, over my undead body.
Guests of the Horror Hall of Fame stayed at Le Parc, a deluxe all-suite hotel of L'Hermitage International, centrally located in West Hollywood, California. Promotional consideration provided by Preferred Stock, the extra smooth cologne for an extra special man. A distinctive gift, new from the House of Stetson. Exclamation, The fragrance that makes a statement without saying a word. Punctuate the air with wit and style. Exclamation, a now kind of fragrance from Coty. Now, from Universal Studios Hollywood, more of the Horror Hall of Fame with your host, Robert Englund.
When I was growing up, kids like me had to hide this magazine. It had something better than naked girls. It had naked ghouls. Our next honoree is the Hugh Hefner of horror, the publisher of Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine, Forrest J. Ackerman.
I have only discovered as an adult how influential Famous Monsters of Filmland was.
Wouldn't be surprised if my real interest in movies, you know, serious interest in movies, started with that magazine.
I don't think there's another person on the planet like Forrest Ackerman.
In Horrorwood, California, there lives a man known as the Sultan of Sci-Fi, the Master of Monsters, Dr. Acula, Forrest J. Ackerman.
Who dares disturb the sleep of the vampire? Oh, I bid you welcome. Don't be afraid.
Meet the Acker Monster, known to an entire generation of horror film fans as Uncle Forry, creator and editor of Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine. A magazine that made mothers cringe and made young boys who dreamt of monsters do anything to get it.
My mother wouldn't let me have them in the house. I saw them at my cousin Scott's house, and I would, you know, read them voraciously, really pore over the, because it was the only magazine out there that actually told you how it was done.
Other magazines tried to imitate, but none had Forry's touch, his true love of science fiction. From the time the first issue of Famous Monsters hit the stand in 1958, through over 200 issues and beyond, the magazine and its creator became almost as famous as the Famous Monsters themselves.
I get almost daily reinforcement letters from young men now in their 30s or so. They say, you made my childhood, and I just lived month for month for your magazine. And these kids grew up, one of them was 14 years old, a man who now gets $10 million advances for books he hasn't written yet, but Stephen King sent me his first story when he was 14. And all around me, little boys have grown up and turned out to be John Landis and George Lucas and Steven Spielberg and Toby Hooper and John Carpenter and Rick Baker, Monster Maker.
I just recently was looking back through some of my old issues to try to find some pictures that I needed for reference for a makeup I was going to do. And it really brings back a funny feeling of the whole time of my life when I had these magazines memorized. I knew what was on each page in each issue of Famous Monsters of Filmland.
And it took the subject seriously. I mean, it was funny, and it had a lot of puns in it, and it was written for an 11-year-old, which was great. But also, it had a tremendous amount of history in it. I mean, he legitimized a very sort of illegitimate kind of movie making that was not taken seriously by anybody but the people who did it. And I think that we all owe him a lot.
Forry is important, and he's important historically. He's, from the time he was a kid with those other weird kids, Ray Harryhausen and Ray Bradbury, they had a very distinct vision of an appreciation of fantasy, not just as pulp, but as a genuine literary or cinematic art form.
I've got the president on the electro scan.
John Landis has so much respect for Forrest Ackerman that he made him the president of the United States.
Come in, men of Moon Rocket One.
In his film, Amazon Women on the Moon.
We read you, Mr. President.
This is a proud day for all Americans.
He did a much better job than the current president.
Forry's a natural. In fact, he's been in lots of films. It's sort of a payback for his inspiration of a generation and for being the ultimate science fiction fanatic.
They're running low on liners. You think you can catch up?
Don't worry. I'm keeping our spacemen happy, getting things squared away.
While movie makers like Landis work to preserve Forry forever on film, he has continued to chronicle the history of horror films, even though Famous Monsters of Filmland is long gone. In the Acker Mansion, where the Acker Monster lives, is the greatest collection of monster, sci-fi, and horror movie memorabilia ever amassed.
In 1926, when I was 9 years old, the science fiction magazine jumped off the newsstand, grabbed hold of me, said, "Take me home, little boy, you will love me."
From there it grew. 3 years after that, my mother was quite concerned. She said, "Son, do you realize how many of these magazines you have?" And I said, "No." And she said, "Well, I just counted them. You have 27. Now, can you imagine why by the time you're a grown man, you might have 100?
At last count, Forrest J. Ackerman had 40,000 books, over 100,000 movie stills, hundreds of posters and autographs, and over 600 props, like the famous Dracula ring given him by his friend Bela Lugosi, and the Mummy's ring, a gift from Boris Karloff.
He's collected everything that ever came his way. I mean, if it was so much as a napkin that Boris Karloff used at a bar. And he's got it all in his house. And not only that, he lets people see it. I mean, he has tours, and he lets kids who rob him blind and look at the stuff, you know. I mean, he's a big kid. He's the biggest kid that I ever met. And I hope he always will be.
Here's lurking at you, babe.
To present the award to Uncle Forey, Rick Baker, Joe Dante, and John Landis.
Why we're behind the camera. Nothing could give us greater pleasure than to present this award tonight to somebody who's meant a lot to us.
Ladies and gentlemen, Forrest J. Ackerman.
Three little lambs that I led astray. I don't know if you're really able to see this quite clearly. It seems to be the Grim Reaper. I'm wondering if he has a relative called Jack the Reaper. I guess without a pun, you wouldn't have believed it was me. Well, we have the Oscars, the Emmys, and the Grammys. And it appears to me that I probably just received the first Grimmy. So, hooray for Hollywood.
I wrote a note to Forrest Ackerman, but it ended up in the dead letter office. Next, a lady who'll kill you with comedy. Don't go away, we'll be right back.
As you know, tonight we'll be presenting an award for the best horror film of the year that you, the moviegoer, chose. All nominees were selected by the editors of Fangoria magazine. The winner was determined through a national poll of votes cast by moviegoers attending Cineplex Odeon Theaters, the nation's leading innovative theater circuit, with more than 1,700 screens in the U.S. and Canada. The poll was conducted in conjunction with Movies USA magazine, the number one in-theater magazine for moviegoers. The results from this exclusive Cineplex Odeon poll have been tabulated and will be announced later in the show. Now, let's take a look at a movie whose stars have great legs. I'm sorry. 8 legs. Our third nominated film, Arachnophobia.
There's a rumor going around that some kind of spider might have killed Sam Metcalf, maybe Margaret, maybe even my Bronco.
Doubtful, Henry. There was a case in Florida where one of my colleagues bumped into a nest of black widows.
sustained over a dozen bites and lived. Of course. He permanently lost control of all of his bodily functions. There's no spider here. But I will hunt down the alleged arachnid and spread some to kingdom come.
Our next guest has been killing audiences for years. Her weapon, a razor-sharp sense of humor. Please welcome the star of the upcoming horror comedy, The Boneyard, Miss Phyllis Diller.
Thank you. I felt so comfortable in that cave, it reminds me of my kitchen. I'm not cut out for housework, I'll tell you that. Fang keeps saying, well, housework never killed anybody. I said, why take a chance? We got a ring around the tub you can set a drink on. Today I used a weed eater on the shower curtain. And, of course, I'm here because I live with a bunch of monsters. Fang, oh, please. Happiest day of my life will be the day I open the refrigerator door and see his face on a milk carton. And then his mother, the real monster, oh, my God. Oh, I don't know how to describe her. Picture Tip O'Neill in a sundress. Halloween, we don't buy a pumpkin. We put her in the window with a match in her mouth. You're talking about older Social Security number 2. Oh, and speaking of old, the best contraceptive for old people is nudity. And be nice to your children because they will be choosing your rest home. I've already chosen one for Fang's mother, the Charles Manson Healthcare Center. That old bat. She went to the doctor with a pain under her left breast. Turned out to be a trick knee.
From Universal Studios Hollywood, the Horror Hall of Fame continues.
Keeping in the spirit of things, our next presenter is a lady who's loved by horror fans from ghost to ghost. From Poltergeist, please welcome Zelda Rubinstein.
In space, no one can hear you scream, but that's not the case in movie theaters when our next inductee burst onto the screen and pioneered a new kind of technological terror. Our sixth inductee is alien.
I haven't figured out my phone yet. Only halfway there. Mother's interrupted the course of our journey. Seems she has intercepted a transmission of unknown origin. She got us up to check it out.
A transmission? Out here?
When Alien, the technological space shocker, was unleashed in 1979, it proved that with a terrifying twist, the classic tale of monster in the house could still grab an audience. Though the action takes place millions of miles from Earth, for screenwriter Dan O'Bannon, the heart of the story was very close to home.
I wasn't just manufacturing this. I reached into my own self and found what frightened me. And it was fairly grueling to write for that reason.
What O'Bannon envisioned was a 50s B horror movie. But like The Alien itself, the film quickly evolved into something awesome. An $8 million journey into terror. At the helm was director Ridley Scott.
In any material, whether you're doing comedy, whether you're doing horror, whether you're doing science fiction or whatever you're doing, the nearer you can get to the truth, then the stronger it's going to be.
It was Scott's vision for detail that turned a run-of-the-mill monster movie into an instant classic. The film was shot at Shepperton Studios in England, where an alien world and an entire spaceship was created to turn fantasy into reality and to get the actors in the mood.
Remember how impressed they seemed by it? It seemed to immediately put them into a different frame of mind when they saw what it was they were going to be working in. They saw the seriousness of it.
I can't act. All I can do is use reality. And it was damned uncomfortable in those tunnels that we were working in. It was hot and uncomfortable. And I play the discomfort. And if the discomfort reads as horror.
Every detail of the film was slaved over, from the surface of the alien planet to the alien itself. And it was that fanatical commitment to realism that left audiences quivering in their seats. But it also left the actors a little shaky, because while everything looked authentic, mechanical details like the oxygen tanks and the spacesuits were sometimes overlooked.
The oxygen had an air hole in there, so we were breathing our own carbon dioxide, and we were dropping like flies.
We had to keep taking helmets off them and on them, you know, because if one of them said, I'm suffocating, we start to panic, you know?
Finally, for a lot of the distance stuff, far distance, Ridley's children did the part, so it makes, you know, it's that old process of using smaller people to make the place look bigger. And once his child passed out, they started realizing something was really wrong.
The alien was clearly the star of the show. He got top billing and most of the attention. After all, it was the hardest part to cast. Designers tried for a year. Then Swiss artist H.R. Giger was brought on board. His bizarre practice of using real animal bones to get what he calls a biomechanical look, combined with Ridley Scott's ominous vision, gave birth to Alien and won Giger an Academy Award for design. Giger's workshop was off limits to everyone but Ridley Scott, so the actors had no clue what the alien looked like until they came face to face. In fact, they all met for the very first time over lunch.
The creature came in under wraps, literally, came in a bag. And so what we did was we rehearsed the scene with the bit, and I told them what was going to happen, that something would occur to John Hurt.
So John Hurt spent the entire morning being installed in this table with a hole in it, having a false lower body attached to him.
So we go down to the set. The stench was unbelievable, for one thing. You thought, oh God, what's going on? They had big buckets of guts and kidneys and fabulous little warts in formaldehyde, and everything was shrouded in plastic. All of the camera crew were wearing raincoats, and they came over to me and they said, you'll be getting a little bit of blood on you, you know, but so I said, okay, fine.
I had five cameras on it. I only wanted to do it once. So then we brought the actors in and we brought it up to where we left off in the action. And at a certain point, we just hit all the lines. And the thing came rocketing out.
When this thing came up, it was unbelievable. They had a jet pointing at my face, a blood jet, which I was going to get a little blood. No, hit me square in the face. All of the reactions are the first time reactions. I flew back over the back of the couch. I mean, there's in the dailies, there's one shot of me with my cowboy boots sailing up like this.
Technicians rushed in from the side and picked up Veronica, carried her limp off the set like an accident victim, drenched in the fake blood.
I think you've got to leave something to people's imagination. And Alien did leave something to your imagination, as you were never quite sure what that thing was. And it could be anywhere. And that allows people to as an audience, I think it's more scared.
In its opening weekend, Alien made film history by earning a record $4 million, an honor previously held by box office bonanza Star Wars.
When you look at it today, 12 years after it was made, I don't think you'd find it has lost anything with time. And I think a true classic is one that when you can look at it afresh 20 years from the time it was made and say, it's lost nothing at all of its emotional content, what it does to you.
This is Ripley, last survivor of the Nostromo, signing off.
Ladies and gentlemen, the star of Alien, Tom Skerritt.
Well, I feel very privileged to have this honor to accept this for Ridley Scott and Gordon Carroll, David Giler, and Dan O'Bannon. I must say that Ridley, apart from directing this film, operated the camera as well, which is a very subjective thing to do. And I recall this scene here that we just saw, the John Hurt extreme indigestion scene. Ridley was looking in the camera and he really hadn't said much to us at that point. And he looked in the camera and after the scene, he lifted his head a little bit and he squinted his camera eye and he said, "Interesting." And that, as I recall, was his only objective directorial comment in 3 months of filmmaking. But it also sums up what my experience was working with Ridley Scott in this film, which was very interesting. And thank you very much for this.
The next nominee for Best Horror Film of the Year stars a bunch of little critters who go to New York and end up mugging it. Our third nominee, Gremlins 2, The New Guy.
I caught me a little terrorist, huh? What's in the bag?
Nothing. Yeah. Let's have a little look at that nothing. Gimme.
I really wouldn't do this if I were you.
Yeah, but you weren't me, are you?
Iron cologne, rugged, sexy, distinctively masculine. Pump some iron today. Lady Stetson, the all-American fragrance for today's spirited woman. Lady Stetson, a declaration of independence. Get ready for a nightmare on your street, and this nightmare's name is Freddy Krueger. This four-player game means four times the fun and terror.
So far, all the films we've honored have come from the USA. American monster movies are popular almost everywhere in the world. But tonight, we'd like to give you a rare glimpse at the creatures of other countries, sort of a grand tour of terror. Your guide for this rare odyssey is the rising star of horror, a real little terror, the star of Child's Play 2 and Barbie's worst nightmare. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Chucky!
Thanks, Robert. Hey,
thought you weren't going to be in makeup tonight. All right, listen. I'm here to show you some great moments from horror flicks around the world. Roll it, Fellini.
If it's a grisly little Dutch treat from Holland that proves that waiting for an elevator can be murder. It's called The Lift.
God, it's moving. I can't help.
And this flick has a title that says it all. Amsterdam. Travel with me now to the black hole of Calcutta. India's horror fans are treated to a Taj Mahal of terrors. And their movies in between vampire attacks, there are these musical numbers. Now that's scary. When it comes to horror movies, get nervous if it says made in Hong Kong. Here's a little appetizer from China's menu of hot Sichuan screamers. A Chinese ghost story is one of Hong Kong's all-time horror hits. If you don't like to be scared, close your eyes and no Peking. Okay, so they're good. But when it comes to spending your hard-earned money on a real movie, remember, buy American. Go see Child's Play 2. That's it, England. Get my limo. I'm out of here.
Thanks, Chucky. You're a real doll. Our next honoree is an actor who's appeared on the Shakespearean stage, but on screen he's known to millions of fans as the Merchant of Menace. We're happy tonight to give him another well-deserved title, the seventh inductee into the Horror Hall of Fame, Mr. Vincent Price. Born in St. Louis, Missouri in 1911, Vincent Price knew at an early age that he wanted to be an actor. In 1935, he made his debut in a small part in a London musical and soon won the coveted role of Prince Albert opposite Helen Hayes in Victoria Regina. After a successful Broadway run, Vincent went to Hollywood, where he got his first taste of terror from Boris Karloff and Basil Rathbone in the Tower of London. Then, in 1940, Vincent mysteriously disappeared in The Invisible Man Returns. For the next 13 years, Vincent's horror career seemed dead, until it suddenly sprang to life in the 3D classic House of Wax, with Price as a deranged sculptor who uses his art to mask a sinister secret.
Everything I ever loved has been taken away from me. Not you, my Marie Antoinette, for I will give you eternal life.
Inspector, it's in the garden. Come quickly.
Please, what's it alarm?
Philippe has seen it. It's there. I beg of you, please, please.
All right, show me where.
Though he continued to play in straight drama, by the late 50s, horror was hot again. And Vincent's reputation as a monster movie idol grew as he played the helpless, horrified brother of the Fly.
It's a good boy, Philippe.
Vincent had found a home in horror movies, and soon he proved how hair-raising a host he could be in The House on Haunted Hill.
I'm Frederick Lauren, and I've rented the house on Haunted Hill tonight so that my wife can give a party, a haunted house party. She's so amusing. Who are you?
The 60s opened the door for Vincent's golden age of horror,
when he signed with American International Pictures for a series of films based on the works of Edgar Allan Poe, stylishly directed by the King of the B-movies, Roger Corman. The Fall of the House of Usher, The Pit and the Pendulum, The Mask of the Red Death, The Tomb of Ligeia were among Price's finest performances as he played brooding heroes, haunted by family curses, tormented by fear, and obsessed with bizarre premonitions of doom.
You are about to enter hell, Bartholomew. Hell! The Neverworld. The infernal regions. The abode of the damned. The place of torment. Pandemonium. Abaddon. Tophet. Gehenna. Naraka. The pit. And the pendulum. The razor edge of destiny.
Horror fans around the world hailed Vincent Price as the screen's only rightful heir to the legacy of Chaney, Karloff, and Lugosi. In 1971, Vincent created what may be his most memorable movie madman, the abominable Dr. Fibes.
You remaining minutes are all you have, because when the acid reaches him, he will have a face.
Fibes rose again for a sequel, and Vincent continued to add to his gallery of ghoulish creations in films like Madhouse, Theater of Blood, and The Monster Club. In the 80s, Vincent conquered a whole new medium, the music video, as the monster rap master for Michael Jackson.
And though you fight to stay alive, your body starts to shiver, for no mere mortal can resist the evil of the thriller.
For half a century, Vincent Price has been scaring us in the dark. And he continues to shine as one of Hollywood's brightest and best-loved stars. Without a doubt, he's brought a unique macabre magic to movie history. A truly priceless contribution that lives on and on.
Is there no end to your horror?
No. None whatsoever.
Vincent could not be with us tonight, so he went to his home in the haunted hills of Hollywood instead. To present the award is an actor whose films include Planet of the Apes and more recently Fright Night, and whose friendship with Vincent goes back 40 years. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Roddy McDowell.
Well, now, Vincent, because we have known each other for so many decades, almost five to be exact, and because I think you are one of the sweetest, kindest, dearest, most elegant fellows I've ever met in my life, I think it is totally appropriate that I'm honored to give you the Lifetime Achievement Award for being just plain evil.
Oh, thank you, Roddy.
And on behalf of all of those millions who you've terrorized and thrilled and scared and delighted, just scared right out of their seats, I'm very honored to induct you into the Horror Hall of Fame.
Wonderful. Wow. Wonderful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Honor of his induction into the Horror Hall of Fame. You know, when I heard that you were going to be kind enough to present this to me, I knew that you would come dressed correctly, beautifully dressed, as always, groomed, as they say. But I didn't quite know what to wear to be an inductee into the Horror Hall of Fame, so I put on my usual little outfit of touch of blood, little death, and no face. I love it. It's wonderful. And I'm very thrilled. You know, quite truly, for all of us who have been in horror pictures throughout the years, we've all thought that they've been vastly underrated. They've done an awful lot for movies to bring people into pictures, to thrill people, to give them the fun of a scare. And also, I think, to bring a lot of people together. You know, when I used to take my girlfriends to early horror films with my friends Boris Karloff and people like that, It was wonderful because she would lean over and grab my hand. And many, many a romance has come out of that. Just think of it. I'm a romantic actor, and I thank you.
Congratulations, Vincent. We all love you very much indeed. Thank you.
Beautiful. Bless you.
Hello, I am the creature from the Blonde Lagoon. You thought I was in New York. Joke's on you, Vinny. I am here to say congratulations. No one deserves the honor more. For years, you scared all of us. You made us shiver in fear. You've sent chills up or down our spine. And to think we paid $6.50 a ticket, Vincent, we could have gotten the same feelings on the street for free. Anyhow, congratulations. I love you so much. I'm glad you're in the Horror Hall of Fame. You are just the best.
Whoops! I got buried under all this paperwork. Somewhere here is the winner of the best horror films of the year. Dying to know, aren't you? Good. You'll find out after these gravely important messages.
The Horror Hall of Fame continues.
This next film featured an underground star that really gave audiences the shakes. Our fifth and final nominee for Best Horror Film of the Year, Tremors.
Must be a million of them.
Nope, just one.
Thank you very much. Somebody said, oh yes, okay, there it is. A huge monitor with all the, but it's not so huge that I'm not going to need these. Okay. I'm here tonight to present the award for the best horror film of the year. The nominees are Dark Man. I didn't see that. Nightbreed. I'm sorry I missed that. Arachnophobia, I'm definitely planning on that one. Gremlins 2. And the one that you just saw the clip from, Tremors. The winner, Arachnophobia. Accepting the award is the director of Arachnophobia, Mr. Frank Marshall.
Thank you very much. I was just happy to be nominated, but to win this wonderful award and be amongst these great movies that we had this summer is really unbelievable. As most of you know, it takes many, many different people to make a movie. So I'd like to share this award with some of them. Our writers, Don Jacoby and Wesley Strick, executive producer, Steven Spielberg, my producers, Kathleen Kennedy and Dick Vane, a fantastic crew, including many, many spider wranglers running around after the spiders that got loose, and a great cast. Oh my heavens. Well, actually, this award really belongs to the star of Arachnophobia, and I think he should be here to pick it up, and here he is, Big Bob. Thank you very much.
Hi, Bob. Thank you very much. The Horror Hall of Fame from Universal Studios Hollywood. We'll be right back.
Congratulations. Congratulations to all of the Horror Hall of Fame inductees. And a special thank you to my good friend from HBO, The Crypt Keeper.
Good night, Robert. See you on Tales from the Crypt, kiddies. Unpleasant dreams.
I look forward to seeing you all next year when we do the sequel, Horror Hall of Fame 2. Good night, everybody. Thanks for coming.
The Horror Hall of Fame has been brought to you by Trident Sugarless Gum and by the full line of quality cars from Hyundai. Yes, Hyundai. And by Pepperidge Farm Cookies. Promotional consideration provided by U.S. Air. This winter, U.S. Air offers low fares to the Bahamas, Puerto Rico, Florida, California, and Arizona. Call your travel consultant on U.S. Air, America's most frequent flyer. Stetson Cologne. Great masculine scent that's easy to wear and hard for a woman to resist. Stetson fits. For fast relief of acid indigestion, use 1,000 milligrams strong extra strength Rolaids. The only antacid in an assortment of mint flavors.
Straight ahead tonight on the Channel 11 News, we're going to have the very latest on the strike at the Daily News.
Will the paper make it to your doorstep or the newsstand in the morning? Well, the next few hours will tell the story.
We're also going to meet a couple expecting a baby. Both are reporters, both on strike against the news.
Anti-tax protests here and across the country on the day Congress and the President finally agree on a budget.
The issue of housing desegregation heating up again up in Yonkers, we'll have that story.
Plus, can microwave popcorn be hazardous to your health?
And a sneak preview of The Godfather Part 3 and other Christmas blockbusters.
And Bob's got quite a day, too.
Yes, Donna, we have tragedy at Belmont Park today at the Breeders' Cup. The Lions roar in the Ivy League, and we'll take a look at the Giants-Redskins game and tradition.
That and are we close to a cure for baldness? We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Many of the films featured on the Horror Hall of Fame are now available on home video from these leading home video distributors.
Tomorrow night at 6, I scream, you scream, we all scream for Stephen King's Creepshow. Starring Ted Danson, tomorrow at 6 on Channel 11.